Hey, 42 here. Imagine you were starting a new business to build and sell mobile phones. How would you go about doing it? I imagine you'd try and make yourself stand out from the crowd with new and interesting features, durable build quality, and a bold and attractive design. You'd pretty much just try and make the best product you possibly could, right? That's probably what I'd do too. But what if I was to tell you that, at least to a certain extent, many big companies around the world are actually doing exactly the opposite of that. They're trying to make the worst products possible that you'll still buy. That might sound counterintuitive at first, but when you think about it, it makes perfect sense. Companies don't exist to make the best products. They exist to make the most money. And building the best product imaginable isn't always the best way to do that. You see, we live in an age of incredible technological advances, which means engineers are better equipped than ever before to make extremely durable and high quality products. That's great for us consumers, but for big businesses, it spells trouble. Better engineered products are not cheaper to make and don't necessarily increase short-term profits. And because customers can keep them for longer before replacing them, future sales are going to take a hit. On the face of it, all of this might just sound like the inevitable byproduct of improving technology, but plenty of companies have found sneaky ways around it by employing a design policy known as planned obsolescence. The practice of deliberately shortening the lifespan of a product. It's a concept you may well be familiar with, but do you know where it came from? Like all the best and most morally corrupt ideas, it started with a light bulb moment. Or, in this case, an actual light bulb. The light bulb was, of course, invented by Thomas Edison in 1879. I'm kidding. Don't spam me with angry comments. Edison didn't invent the light bulb. Much of the technology for which can be attributed to inventors and scientists like Humphrey Davy, Warren De La Rue, and Joseph Swan, who'd been working on various aspects of the problem for some 80 years before Edison got involved. But all those who came before Edison focused largely on the scientific challenges involved with turning electricity into light, meaning their bulbs were, for one reason or another, simply not practical for mass production. In 1840, for example, British scientist De La Rue designed an efficient light bulb using a coiled platinum filament. It worked just fine, but any guy who's ever been shopping for an engagement ring will know that platinum is wallet-meltingly expensive, meaning De La Rue's design was simply too pricey to ever realistically light homes around the world. And that's where Thomas Edison came in. Edison seems to get a lot of stick these days, but there's no denying he was one of the most prolific inventors ever to have lived, with more than 1,000 patents to his name. And what really set him apart from many of history's other great tinkerers was that he was also an incredibly astute businessman. Edison measured the success of his inventions not by their ingenuity or even their utility, but by their commercial success. And I have to agree with him. Most inventions are only useful to you and me if we can pop to the shop and buy it for a reasonable price. For light bulbs to sell, he knew they had to be both cheap to manufacture and reliable to use. His achievement in perfecting the light bulb is often trivialized today, but make no mistake, it was a monumental undertaking. It's said that Edison tested 3,000 different light bulb designs and a further 6,000 or so materials for use in his filaments before getting it just right. It was such hard work, in fact, that it was this Edison was referring to when he coined his most famous saying. Genius is 1% inspiration, 99% perspiration. Luckily for him, all those unsightly sweat patches eventually paid off when he hit upon a light bulb design that ticked all the boxes. It was relatively cheap and simple to make. The filament burnt brightly, and it had the staying power to function for an impressive 1,200 hours. The electric light was ready to take the world by storm. Incidentally, the breakthrough material Edison ended up using for his filaments was not tungsten, as is found in incandescent light bulbs these days, but carbonized bamboo, which Edison had harvested and imported from just outside of Kyoto. A monument to the great inventor can be found in nearby Iwazumizu Hashiman Shrine to this day. Over the following years, others began to improve on Edison's bulbs, with each new design a little more resilient than the last. Before long, top-of-the-line light bulbs were remarkably reliable. In fact, the longest burning incandescent light bulb in history, the Centennial Light, which can be found in a fire station in Livermore, California, was first switched on in 1901 and has been burning almost continuously ever since. The Guinness World Record holding bulb is so famous, it even has its own hair-raising live stream where you can experience its still not gone out yet magnificence firsthand. Whatever gets you going, I guess. It's fair to say that early 20th century light bulbs weren't just for Christmas. Like puppies and botched plastic surgery, they were for life, at least potentially. And that was great news for everyone, or should I say almost everyone. For light bulb manufacturers, such extravagant increases in light bulb longevity were about as welcome as a fart in a sauna. German light bulb manufacturer Osram was one of those who saw their sales nosedive in an almost perfect negative correlation with increasing burn times. In the space of just a year between 1922 and 1923, Osram's sales dropped from 63 million units to just 28 million. The light bulb giant was left with two options. They could down tools, safe in the knowledge they just illuminated all of Germany for the next century or so, or they could instead form a shady international organization intent on sabotaging the production of light bulbs around the world. Okay, so they probably weren't the only two options, but either way, Osram opted for the latter. What was more, they knew exactly how to do it, by forming an international cartel. Now, when you hear the word cartel, there's a fair chance your brain conjures up images of short guys with excellent mustaches standing proudly next to piles of white powder. But a cartel is actually just a group of people or companies who collude with one another in an attempt to manipulate and dominate a given market. Which is exactly what Osram had in mind when they founded the Phoebus Cartel. Phoebus, by the way, is another name for the Greek deity Apollo, god of the sun and bringer of light. See what they did there? Anyway, the first thing on the Phoebus Cartel's to-do list was to get as many other light bulb manufacturers involved in their little scheme as possible. You might think something this dodgy sounding would have put off the big boys, but no. You see, no doubt hidden behind a lot of marketing jargon and corporate buzzwords, Osram were offering their fellow conspirators something no businessman in history has ever been able to resist. A guarantee of more cash. Associated Electrical Industries in the UK, Tokyo Electric in Japan, and Philips in the Netherlands were all quick to sign up, as was General Electric, the company that had formed out of Thomas Edison's own clutch of electricity businesses, including the Edison Electric Light Company. So, what exactly was the cartel planning to do? They were going to single-handedly reverse decades of progress in electric lighting technology in the space of just a few short years. At the time of the cartel's formation in 1925, the average burn time of a light bulb was rated at around 2,500 hours. That meant if you were to burn your trusty bulb for a modest 5 hours a day, it would last about 500 days. But through the diligent work of a loyal team of morally challenged engineers, the Phoebus Cartel set about actively reducing the life expectancy of bulbs made by their companies to just 1,000 hours. Reducing its real-world lifespan to about 200 days. The idea was, of course, very simple. The faster the bulbs failed, the sooner people would need to buy new ones, and the more money the manufacturers would make. Planned obsolescence had been born. But it's harder than you might think to design a light bulb that fails after almost exactly 1,000 hours, and top minds within the cartel dedicated considerable manpower and budget to the task, testing various modifications and filaments to ensure consistent and predictable early failure. And having set their 1,000-hour limit, the cartel strictly enforced it. All member companies were obliged to submit sample bulbs for testing at a central lab, and manufacturers whose bulbs exceeded the burn limit were fined for making products that were too reliable. The cartel even printed up a fine table that detailed how penalties would increase steadily the longer bulbs lasted over the 1,000-hour mark. And not content with simply forcing their customers to buy their products more often, the cartel even had the big swinging balls, I mean bulbs, to hike their prices whilst they were at it. In many ways, light bulbs are the perfect products for planned obsolescence. Because they last a relatively long time and customers tend to own lots of them, meaning there's a fair chance they won't notice when one fails a little earlier than expected. And it seems consumers were indeed largely unaware of the steps being taken to rip them off by the board members of some of the world's biggest companies. Because Phoebus Cartel Company's sales soared. In 1926, a year after the cartel formed, Phoebus members sold 336 million light bulbs globally. 4 years later, that number had rocketed to 421 million. Sales might have been higher still had Phoebus bosses not imposed strict quotas on member companies to ensure no one member claimed too much of the global market. It does make one wonder if they noticed the hypocrisy of a cartel intent on monopolizing the global market, enforcing anti-monopoly laws. The cartel was incredibly influential at its height, but much like one of their own bulbs, it simply wasn't going to last. The first blow came when General Electric's basic light bulb patents, some of which were inherited from Edison himself, began to expire at the end of the 1920s, bringing a flood of new competition to the market. Competition that was, of course, free to make their bulbs last as long as they wanted in order to snatch market share from Phoebus members. But whether or not that would have broken the cartel's stranglehold on light bulb sales will never be known, because a few years later, something even more devastating came along and killed Phoebus off entirely. The Second World War. Remember, this was a multinational operation based on cross-border collusion. As fighting broke out across the world, companies within the cartel suddenly found themselves trying to do business whilst technically at war with one another. By 1940, the world's first global cartel had broken up entirely. Today, 80 years on, you might think that kind of anti-consumer skullduggery that was the hallmark of the Phoebus cartel would be impossible. What with strict laws to abide by and the watchful eyes of market regulators overseeing everything. But in reality, whilst Phoebus is no more, the central concept that gave the cartel so much success has, much like the centennial bulb, only less boring, continued to burn brightly in the intervening decades. Because planned obsolescence did not die with Phoebus. In fact, quite the opposite. It's been enthusiastically adopted by companies all over the world. Planned obsolescence takes many forms, some sneakier than others. Some manufacturers carefully design their products to be unrepairable by the consumer, Apple, using proprietary screw heads and sealed body designs. Others use fragile components in high wear areas to ensure an otherwise durable product breaks sooner than expected. You'll all have noticed the change mobile phone manufacturers have made to stop making batteries user replaceable, and the constant cycle of new releases and design tweaks between generations that make your brand new device seem outdated after just a few months. And, as was the case with the Phoebus cartel, some of the most influential companies in the world have been known to employ these tactics. In 2017, Apple was found guilty of artificially slowing down older iPhones, something they claimed to do in order to protect the performance of degraded batteries. No doubt it was a totally unexpected benefit that this safety measure also encouraged people to upgrade sooner as their old phones became unusable. Apple were fined 25 million euro by France's Competition and Fraud Watchdog for the misdemeanor. Which sounds like a lot, but at the time, Apple was making profits to the tune of around $1,500 per second, meaning they made their money back in just 5 hours. In another high-profile case, French regulators also took aim at the home printing industry, accusing the likes of Epson, HP, Canon, and Brother of designing their ink cartridges to register as empty, not when the ink had run out, but after a certain number of pages had been printed, or even just after a certain amount of time had elapsed. The companies were fined 15,000 euro apiece. As frustrating as all this can be, it isn't quite as straightforward as planned obsolescence equals evil corporate greed. After all, the millions upon millions of additional gizmos and gadgets sold to us each year, thanks to planned obsolescence, provide huge numbers of jobs, a healthy boost to the economy, and countless additional tax dollars that can be used to improve public health systems and other key infrastructure. When you think about it, planned obsolescence is the engine room of capitalism, driving consumerism forwards and making sure we're all spending all the time. The question is, how do you balance that with the increased environmental impact and the lack of value for the customer? The answer to that question is a topic for another day. But one thing's for sure. Planned obsolescence may have started with the humble light bulb 100 years ago. But considering how embedded it is in the global economy, it isn't going anywhere anytime soon. Thank you for watching. You can now buy my new book, Stick a Flag in It, on Amazon, or get the audiobook on Audible. You'll find a link to both in the description below. Thank you.